Gen 4 International Forum webinar presentation. Today's presentation is on the Advanced Lead-Fast Reactor European Demonstrator, otherwise known as ALFRED project. Today's presenter joins us from Italy. Doing today's introduction is a person not unknown to the GIF webinars, Dr. John Kelly. John is the chairman emeritus of the Generation 4 International Forum, and he'll do today's introductions. John?
Thanks, Huberta. So today, good morning to everyone, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world. Today we have Dr. Alessandro Almaberti, who is the Nuclear Science Department Manager of Ansaldo Nuclear, and in this position he takes care of the research and development activities for the company. He coordinated the ELSA and LEADER projects in the framework of the 6th and 7th Framework Program of the European Community, projects devoted to lead-cooled fast reactors development, and participated well to the main EU projects related to lead and lead-bismuth eutectic coolant technologies in recent years. From 2012, he serves as the chairman of the Gen 4 lead-fast reactor provisional steering committee, representing Euratom. After receiving the degree of physics at the University of Genoa in 1979 and joining Ansaldo in 1981, he dedicated his efforts to thermohydraulic simulations of light water reactor safety and licensing, and participated in the research projects like the OECD LOFT, as well as to the AP600 and SBWR activities. He is the author of a number of papers and patents devoted to the development of passive safety. And in 2017, he was awarded the title of Maestro del Lavoro by the President of the Italian Republic. So, Alessandro, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, John, for your kind presentation. And thank you to Berta and Patricia for organizing this webinar series, including also ALFRED project in this webinar. And welcome to all the audience. I see now 37 participants to this online webinar. I like to start my presentation with an outline of the presentation itself. First of all, I will talk a little bit, just one slide, on the history of lead coolant development in Europe. Then I would like to trace a picture of the European context and the Falcon Consortium, which is in support of the ALFRED project. Then we go back to 2010, at the beginning of the LEADER project, was the project used to define the main design of ALFRED reactors, the present ALFRED status then, and finally, to conclude the presentation, we will take a look on the last technology development, especially in terms of material respect to lead coolant contact, and the awareness of the status of this technology we have reached. And then just some word on the ALFRED strategy in the near future for the development of ALFRED. Let's go to this bit of history in Europe. You see on the top of this slide three different name of projects. The first one is preliminary design studies for experimental accelerator-driven system, PDS-XIDS. It was a project of a fifth framework program from 2002 to 2004. Then you see the IP Eurotrans and the CDT project in the successive years that brought all those projects, all those three projects brought to the development of a MIRA accelerator-driven system, already presented in a previous webinar by Hamid, Professor Hamid. In parallel to this accelerator-driven system technology, which uses as a basis the heavy liquid metal coolant technology, in 2006 we started a project called ELSI, the European LED system, which was the design of an industrial-sized LED fast reactor up to 600 megawatt electric, to give confidence that on the feasibility of such an industrial size reactor. Then in the from 2010 to 2013 we started a leader project which modified the ELSI design, and we called this new design of the industrial size machine ELFR, European LED Fast Reactor. And then we sited down a scaled demonstrator of the ELFR at the size of around 100 megawatt electric, and we called it ALFRED, Advanced LED European Fast Reactor Demonstrator. If we go to see a little bit the European context in which we move in terms of fast reactor, we have one main initiative, which is the Sustainable Nuclear Energy Technology Platform, SNETP, which is based on three main pillars. The first pillar is Nugenia, which is a pillar dealing with research and safety characteristic of generation 2, 3, and 3 plus reactors, and is mainly dedicated to further development of such reactors. Then we have another pillar called NC2I, which means Nuclear Cogeneration Industrial Initiative, which is dedicated to the development of nuclear energy to have also in parallel not only electricity production but also heat production, high temperature heat production for industrial applications. And then the last one is the ESNI. ESNI is the European Sustainable Nuclear Industrial Initiative, and is based this pillar is really dealing with the word sustainability, because it's based on fast reactors, and fast reactor can make use of a closed, so-called closed fuel cycle, which can increase the use of natural resources of uranium and plutonium up of a factor of 50 respect to the present light water reactor technology. ESNI is based on four main initiatives: the ASTRID, which is the sodium fast reactor prototype, MIRA as a irradiation facility and demonstrator for the accelerator-driven system technology, ALLEGRO, which is a gas fast reactor, and then ALFRED, the LED fast reactor demonstrator. So we have those four initiatives pertaining to ESNI. Two of them, ALFRED and MIRA, are based on the same technology, which is the heavy liquid metal technology. And in this technology, European Community invested more than 200 million euro in the last 10 years. This to give you an idea of the efforts that are being spent on this new technology by the European Community. Let's go to the next slide. Talking about ALFRED support, we have to cite first the formation of a Falcon Consortium, which is a consortium of three different entities, organization: ANSADO Nucleare, INEA, which is the research lab in Italy, and RATEN ICNP Testi, which is the research lab for nuclear matters in Romania. Falcon Consortium was established first in 2013 to bring LFR technology to industrial maturity, And we evolved this consortium recently to better cope with the European context. The main objectives of this consortium are a firm commitment to Alfred as a major project in Romania, finalization of Alfred feasibility study, and the construction of supporting, in the first phase, R&D facilities for Alfred. We are presently inviting many industrial and research lab European partners to take part of this evolution, to bring their knowledge and support to this initiative. In terms, we want to involve the whole heavy liquid metal community of Europe at first in this initiative to perform development of this new reactor technology. About Romania, I remember I talked the first time at the leader kickoff meeting about Romania representative, and we had from Romania the availability in 2011 to host the Alfred reactor on the Mioveni site that you see here in the map. Then, in this slide, I present many different initiatives and steps that have been made in Romania in the years from 2011 to today. One of the main initiatives was the inclusion of Alfred in the smart specialization strategy of the South Muntenia region. Then, in 2016, Alfred was included also as a priority in the National Energy Strategy of Romania. And in 2017, we had at the Nuclear Congress in Pitești the commitment to support a share of 20% of the total cost of Alfred by the Romanian government. Then, in February this year, there was an issue of a Romanian position paper on Alfred, and in March 2018, ESNI, the European Sustainable Nuclear Industrial Initiative, included Alfred in the demonstrator fast track for the European community. So now Alfred is in a front position in terms of evolution of demonstrators. If we go back now to the 2010 year when we started the LEADER project that was originating the first design of Alfred, I have to thank all those organizations. I will not cite them, but you see all the symbols here in this slide that participated to this really successful project. When we started with this project, we really realized that we were using a completely new technology, and we needed to develop a new concept. So we made some main decision for the development of this technology. We decided to go from a small realization to bigger size realization, so following an evolution of a project which goes from a demonstrator, Alfred, to a medium-sized prototype called the Pro-LFR, prototype LFR, and then to the full-size, first-of-a-kind reactor called the ELFR. In those technical evolution, we tried to identify the main advantages and also the issues related to the use of such a technology. Then, also in terms of facilities, we started from small facilities to go to larger size facilities. Then we know that we need irradiation test in the current environment specific of this new technology. And when making the design of Alfred, the first design, we try to exploit the full potential of the coolant, including from the beginning, not adding it, but including from the beginning, safety in the design. Show also one of our object was the, to show the sustainability of the fuel cycle in terms of final industrial application. And then define and evolve a reference conceptual design of a first-of-a-kind reactor to use it as a reference for scaling down the demonstrator. This was the main concept that we tried to use when we started our development of a LIDER project. And so I like it also to add to this slide some very early sketch of the configuration that I developed for the presentation, for the first presentation at the kickoff meeting of LIDER. And you see how rough it is, this sketch, but try to identify the main characteristic of a reactor that at that time we wanted to develop. What are the main design characteristics that are very useful and can be used as a basis for the development of this new design? First of all, the fact that lead does not react with water or air. So the idea is that we can install a steam generator using water, normally high pressure water, and they can be installed directly inside the reactor vessel. Also, there is a very high boiling point, 1745 degrees C of lead, which exclude practically any boiling possibility of a coolant inside the core with void feedbacks on the core reactivities. But also, very low vapor pressure of a lead at the reference temperature of 400 degrees C, which means that we have no practically vapor of lead inside the cover gas, and we have practically no lead deposition on cold surfaces. Also, another very important characteristic is that we have to take into account is the high density of lead. And one of the main advantages we identified is that in case of breached fuel dispersion, a dispersion mechanism instead of a compaction mechanism is favored. Lead is also a low moderating medium and has low absorption cross-section in terms of neutron absorption. So in a lead fast reactor, you don't need to use a compact fuel rod design. You can use a very large P over D parameter, pitch over diameter parameter. And this is not imposed like in other design by the neutronic design of a core, but can be defined by thermal hydraulic characteristic of a core. So can be defined by the thermal hydraulic design of a reactor itself. So our request to the design was to obtain very low pressure losses in the whole primary system. And we assigned approximately 1 bar for core and 0.5 bar for the steam generator. In total, 1.5 bar for the primary loop. This allow us to obtain a very high primary natural circulation capability, and also we can implement natural circulation decay heat removal system. So including also passive safety from the beginning in the design of the reactor. This is why always we say lead coolant imply also in some way and favor the use of passive safety inside the reactor. Obviously, we have not only advantages in terms of coolant, we have also some issues to be faced. The first one, for example, is the high lead melting point, which is 330 degrees C around. So we have to keep lead temperature above 340, 350 degrees C in all operation states, also in refueling states, for example. So we will probably need, and we understood this from the beginning, that we need a heating system and also take particular care in the development of design and operating procedures. Also, for the same reason, we needed to face overcooling transient in order to prevent any possible freezing of lead, which may impair the coolant circulation inside the reactor. So we have a very strict requirement in terms of feed water and decay heat removal requirements. One of the main problem issues of the use of, in general, heavy liquid metal coolant is the corrosion erosion of structural materials, and also the possible sludge accumulated inside the primary coolant, depending on the operating condition. I will have a slide at the end of the presentation taking care of this problem directly. In any case, we started from the beginning development of coating, oxygen control strategies, limitation of flow velocity to limit the erosion of the effect of a coolant. We also have developed a strategy which use a low oxygen content in the sense that we would like to have an extremely clean coolant, but without affecting the integrity, obviously, of the structural material. The density of lead is not only an advantage, is also a problem due to seismic risk. You have a strong weight to face. And so we decided that our reactor will be mounted on seismic isolator. This gives us many advantages in terms of standardization of design and reduction of the seismic consequences on the reactor itself. Then we have to develop a specific in-service inspection of core support structures, procedure and machines for fuel loading and unloading, and you will see how we faced also this this development. We would like also to take care of steam generator tube rupture, because we will use high pressure water inserted into the primary side, and we do not want to impair the primary side, which is at atmospheric pressure, by the ingress of water which comes into the lead due to a steam generator tube rupture. Then, again, in relation with sludge accumulation, we have to face flow blockage and mitigation of consequences of partial or total flow blockage on the core of the reactor. So we developed some design guidelines at the beginning of the LIDAR project. We wanted our machine, Alfred, to be connected to the grid, to show that it is able to produce power and dispatch to the network, to the electrical network. We also said that Alfred should be based on the available technology as much as possible. And you will see at the end how we will try now to develop a strategy to implement this this point. Alfred shall also use structural materials compatible with the corrosive lead used as coolant, and we selected some candidate materials, the 316 and the 1515 titanium. Alfred also limited the coolant flow velocity to value compatible with the erosive lead used as a coolant, so we said from the beginning that we will limit this velocity up to 2 meters per second inside the primary side. Design solution of Alfred shall allow also components to be removed, and in fact in our design practically all components can be removed from the top of the reactor. Safety and decay removal solution should be characterized by robust and reliable choices to smooth as much as possible the licensing process, and we decided from the beginning again to use the passive technology as a basis of this development. And this was the how Alfred looks like at the end of the LEADER project. The main idea is to have here the core, you can see here, with the fuel element in this region. Flow comes from the bottom, called lead flow, to the core. Then enter this plenum, this region, goes to such tubes, curved tubes, which may feed the pump, which elevate the flow, the lead up to 1 meter and a half respect to this, which is the total pressure drop of the system. Then binet tubes are used as a steam generator, and the lead goes back cold to the reactor. You can see a top view here of this reactor, in which you see the pump, this small circle, 8 pumps, with this shape, C shape, of a binet tube tube bundle of a steam generator. The main characteristic of the reactor are we sized the heat at 300 megawatt thermal, which means with our expected cycle efficiency about 42% efficiency, 125 megawatt electric. The primary cycle is atmospheric with a temperature difference from cold to hot regions from 400 to 480 degrees C. Secondary cycle is a well-known cycle, superheated steam cycle at 180 bars from 335, which is a temperature slightly above lead freezing temperature, lead melting temperature, to 450 degrees C for a high efficiency of a turbine. And you see in this slide, in this table, the main characteristic of a different part of the reactor. You can note we have two vessels. As usual in those type of reactor, we have a main vessel and a safety vessel. Here is the steam generator, the main coolant pump. The vessel is hanged to the top of this support structure by a Y junction that will be described in the following. And you can also note a particular solution that we used to have to simplify fuel handling. We extended the fuel assemblies up to the cover gas region so that all fuel assembly can be directly visible from the top of the reactor itself. And this will imply that we will have no fuel handling machine inside lead. The fuel landing machine will operate only on a cover gas region. Okay. Going ahead with some small particular description of the reactor, we have to start from the reactor core, because the reactor core is the basic part that we designed first in order then to size all other components around the core. We have 171 hexagonal rubbed fuel assemblies that you see here, with a number of pins inside, with all dimensions. Here is a pin representation, and here is the fuel assembly from the foot, from the bottom to the top. Here is the active region, and then here, from some holes in this point, the flow, the coolant flow, is directed to the pump. We have two different regions in terms of plutonium enrichment, described here in this table, and two different systems for control of reactivity, the control rod system, 12 control rods here in these points, blue fuel assemblies, and four safety rods to shut down and scram the reactor itself. Here you see different sections in different points of the fuel assemblies. How such control rods works, control and safety rod works. Such design was developed together with a CDT project, with a concurrent project, and the same control rods are used also practically in MIRA. In fact, such control rods have been developed for MIRA originally in the CDT project and then adapted to the Alfred reactor. Control rod here represented, you see the absorbed location. They are withdrawn from below the core and are inserted, pushing the control rod up, which means that control rods are moved by motor, but in case of accident, they can be passively inserted, simply relieving them, and they are inserted by buoyancy, because they float inside the lead. Also, instead the safety rod, which is represented here, are inserted instead from top to bottom, and they are withdrawn from bottom to top. And they are forced by passively, they are forced and passively inserted by a pneumatic mechanism, but also there is a backup mechanism, which is a tungsten ballast, which forces by gravity the safety rod inside the core. So we have two different control system for reactivity to control the power and to scram down the reactor, shut down the reactor. Both systems are inserted during refueling, maneuvering, and so on. And both systems are designed against most reactive rod stack. So if one of the rod is released, still the total reactivity is negative. Okay, going to the vessel, some specific characteristic of a vessel. It is a cylindrical with a spherical bottom head anchored to reactor pit from top. Here is the so-called Y junction, which is used to just separate the load due to temperature on this cylindrical structure from the load due to weight, which is carried by this Y junction. Also, you can note this cone frustum in the bottom, which holds the what we call the inner vessel, which is the support of the core, and prevent any movement, horizontal movement of the core in case of a seismic event. Here in this table you have the main characteristic of the reactor vessel itself. This is what we call the inner vessel. It is constituted by a double wall, an external wall, and a thin internal wall which follows the geometry of the fuel assemblies, providing lateral support to the fuel assemblies. This part of the inner vessel is inserted in the cone frustum that we just saw before in the previous slide to prevent any movement in the horizontal direction. Eight bend pipes which bring the coolant flow to the pumps. Connection here to the reactor cover and upper core plate. And here is what we call barrel. Then you see some particular of the lower core plate where the foot of the fuel assemblies are inserted and the upper core plate which holds on the top also the this cover which is provided by spring to force down the fuel assembly when the reactor is in operation. One characteristic is that the inner vessel is radially restrained at the bottom, but it is actually free to expand downwards due to thermal expansion. So there is no loads coming from expansion because it is free. Here again, the main in the table some dimension of the inner vessel for Alfred. Here, when we worked a lot on this assembly of the steam generator and pump for Alfred, here is the typical pump which is inserted into the C-tube bundle, which is made by binary tubes. What is the concept of the binary tubes? First, we have to say that this steam generator is a once-through steam generator, so the feed water enters subcooled, and you see here the main cycle. Enters subcooled here, goes here up to saturation, takes saturation for around 2 to 2 meters, 2 meters and a half. And then we have superheating up to 450 for the exit. And here is the behavior of the lead on the other side, on the primary side. So how this is realized? It's realized using double wall tubes on the left side. You see here feed water is coming in the central tube. There is some insulation to prevent any regeneration effect between the feed water and the steam leaving in this region. Feed water come down, boils, transform into steam, and goes up to this region, then to the turbine. We have, however, here another tube wall, which is filled by high, the gap between the two walls is filled by high conductivity particle to increase the heat exchange. And this provide the possibility to continuous monitoring of the status of a tube bundle of a steam generator. Here you see on the left-hand side the how the pump is coupled with the steam generator. Tubes are arranged in a triangular lattice with a P of a B parameter of 1.42. Typical design condition to prevent any flow-induced vibration problem on tubes. Here you see the Alfred secondary system. We also performed some studies on how to design the balance of plant of Alfred. This is a typical arrangement with a steam line going to the high pressure turbine, low pressure turbine, with some extraction going to feed water heaters, the deaerator, condenser pump from condenser to the aerator, and feed water pumps, which goes back to the reactor. The cycle is a superheated cycle. We said 180 bars at the center of the turbine, with a dual turbine configuration and some extraction on HP and LP, with the main characteristic of the cycle represented in this table. Then also some studies about the buildings, because it is important to understand how this building looks like. And you see here a total height of about 33 meters from zero. The whole building is mounted on seismic isolation, and this was developed in a European project that followed the LIDAR project. It is called the CEDAR project, if you want to take any note to consult this project on the web. We obtained by this seismic isolation a strong reduction of ground acceleration, and this helps a lot in the design standardization of the plant itself, because in reality try to make the design independent from the site where you are going to put your reactor. Safety. As we said, the safety was just one of the first thing that we want really to implement at high level in our reactor. We decided in this reactor to make use of a technology that was developed previously for the simplified boiling water reactor. Also, here is a typical picture of this machine, which is constituted by two headers, one lower header, upper header, and two bundles, and it is called the isolation condenser. The isolation condenser is here represented and is immersed into a pool and isolated by an isolation valve which connect the lower header to the feed water line. When we have to any accident condition in our reactor, the main idea is that the first thing we do is to have an isolation of the containment. So we close the two valves which isolate the feed water line and the main steam line of the steam generator. Then, if we want and need to have a decay heat removal system after the scram has been actuated by the control system, by the protection system, we need to open simply this valve. And how this system works. The machine in normal condition is filled by water because it is connected to the main steam line without valves. So opening these valves, the isolation valves, inject the water inside the tube bundle to the steam generator feed water line, which feed the steam generator and produce steam going out from the outlet of the steam generator. This steam is then condensed by the tube bundle inside the pool. And this provides something that is similar to a natural circulation inside this system and provide passive cooling simply by gravity and condensation mechanism of removing the decay heat from the reactor itself. How this works for the lead fast reactor? You can see here a plot where you see the lead temperature from the beginning of initiation of the operation of this isolation condenser. It takes about 250 minutes, so 4 hours, to bring the lead coolant to the freezing condition. We said during the LIDER project that this was enough for the operator to make some isolation of such DHR system and take some action to prevent any freezing of the system. However, we wanted also to improve the behavior of this system and extend the grace time, what we called the grace time to freezing. So we patented a new system, and we simply added a very simple tank of non-condensable gas, which is shown here in this picture. Here is the condenser. You add this tank, which is a pressurized tank, and it is known from previous experience that we made in the BWR campaign that the presence of non-condensable gas inside the tube bundle will decrease strongly the heat exchange in the tube bundle and will prevent the heat exchange. So the idea is when the system pressure on the secondary side of this system, on the water side of this system, is going to decrease, the non-condensable gas is fed to the tube bundle, preventing the increase of heat exchange. This is the behavior that we just saw in the previous slide. In the 4 hour, we are going to lead freezing. And this is the behavior of the same system equipped with this non-condensable tank. And you see that the timing to freezing is now of the order of weeks. So we increased a lot the grace time able to, able to prevent and delay as much as possible the freezing phenomena in the reactor in a way that operators can act on the reactor to recover the normal condition within this time. Last point about safety is just something which has to do with main characteristic of a lead fast reactor. In the previous slide, when we talked about decay heat removal, decay heat removal systems are normally used when SCRAM is actuated, so when reactor is shut down. However, in such transient that I'm going to present, we suppose that we do not have any SCRAM of the reactor. So the reactor is kept, at full power. And what we will see in terms of response of the reactor is the real characteristic of the lead fast reactor itself. Here you see the evolution of temperature at in the primary side of the reactor for an unprotected, we call it this transient unprotected loss of flow, which means that we lose all the primary pumps. So the reactor goes from forced circulation condition to natural circulation condition. So you have an increase of temperature, But then the feedback of the neutronics into the core will decrease the power of the reactor, let's say by a passive inherent feedback. So in this way, the reactor power is decreased and the coolant temperature is decreased up to a new stable condition, which is not able to produce any major degradation of the core. So the idea is that also if we do not have SCRAM, but we have an accident of loss of flow, we will have some maximum temperature provided by the natural circulation inside the primary side, and the reactor can be managed also in such, let's say, really challenging condition. And this is true not only for this transient, but for all transient unprotected that we simulated inside the project. And it is a basic feature of really of the lead fast reactor based technology. To go to the present Alfred status, I can say that now, presently, the Falcon Consortium is doing a design review, and we have this design review ongoing. We have confirmed the main option, so the location of the pumps, for example, solutions for steam generators and so on. But we also introduced some diversification of decay heat removal system. And we are working presently on aspects that were not directly because of reason of time and funding by the leader project originally developing the Alpha design. Also, in the years from the end of leader project to now, several facilities have been constructed and experiments have been done, and we have to talk about technology development, chemistry and materials possibility, some new ideas about the operational strategy that we can use for Alfred startup, and the experimental facility support ongoing. Here you see, for example, the thanks to ENEA lab, the so-called CIRCE facility, circulation eutectic, and we had an integral experiment of 1 megawatt, and you see here the riser of this facility, then the downcoming of the lead called to the power channel here, which is represented here with grids and so on. Just to give you an idea of the dimension of this facility, the diameter is about 1.2 meter and the height about 10 meters. It was used for oxygen control system testing in large pool, component qualification, steam generator tube rupture experiment were also done, and as also steam generator and pump unit test. Other facilities are, for example, NACIE, natural circulation experiment that you see in this picture, here with a tube bundle, instrumented tube bundle here, up to 250 kilowatt electric, also used for oxygen control system testing in loop, component qualification and the instrumentation test as well. Then, for example, the Lecor loop was one of the first built to test corrosion characteristic of a heavy liquid metal. And the Helena loop that was mainly used for pump testing, here you see the pump impeller for Helena. Some important point that I addressed before at the beginning of this webinar was the chemistry of heavy liquid metal, both lead and LBE. I try to give you an explanation as simple as possible. We have a possibility to add oxygen inside the liquid lead coolant. But we have two different curves in depending on temperature. You see here the temperature, and this is the concentration of oxygen inside the coolant. The blue curve is the maximum curve you have to respect. And the red curve is the minimum concentration of oxygen you have to respect. If you stay with your coolant inside this region, you obtain a condition that we call steel passivation. So the oxide is formed on the surface of the structures, and this protects the structure from corrosion of the coolant itself. What happens if we have too much oxygen? If we have too much oxygen inside the coolant, we are going to produce oxides, lead oxides, and the result is shown here. High oxygen imply slag deposit in your system, which means that you have a dirty coolant, and slag deposit can really plug your system and make blocking your circulation, the coolant circulation in your system. If you want to have a clean coolant instead, you can go to low oxygen, but if you go below this red line, you have still corrosion, and the main way, mode of attack of the material structure when you have low oxygen is the dissolution of the main components of the material, nickel and daughters and chromium, etc., into the coolant itself. So, however, in this condition at low oxygen, you will have a really a clean coolant which is not able to produce a lot of oxide and producing a flow blockage or other negative phenomena. So this is in detail what is the corrosion which attack a piece of 1515 titanium in a static lead at 550 degrees C, and you see visible the different corroded layer of the material. So the main idea was from the beginning to develop coating protection to this material in order to prevent this corrosion. It is known that alumina is not attacked at all by lead, and this is a result of the same material that has been coated by alumina, so aluminum oxide. And this coating was developed by the Italian Institute of Technology in Italy, in Milan. And this is the result of the experiments when we put this coated material inside lead in the same condition previously shown. So for 4,000 hours at 550 degrees C with a low oxygen concentration. This was made by pure pulsed laser deposition, and in this case we have no evidence of lead corrosion, neither at the macroscopic scale nor at the microscopic scale. And this was one of the main, improvement in terms of materials and ideas to be implemented to prevent the corrosion of lead inside our reactor. If we want to have now a small summary about what is the present status and what is our present understanding of the status not only of the Alfred project, but in general of the technology of lead. We can say that we have made many relevant activities that have been performed at the national and the European level, and we have relevant evidence that it is possible to extend significantly our technological base, and we had identified also some solution to the main issues for such technologies. So if we look to what we have in our hand, which is represented by this figure, now we are aware of a much higher technology readiness of what we previously thought. So we can target for the development of and the implementation of such a technology a time frame which goes from 2035 to 2040 for the industrial exploitation of this technology itself. This would be the proper time window to exploit this market segment, and also this shortened perspective is able to raise much more the industrial interest. So at the end, we tried also following the design guidelines that we followed in the LEADER project to try to use from the beginning in the development of Alfred and the commissioning of Alfred and the operation materials that are already available. So our strategy to operate Alfred reactor is to follow different phases. In phase one, we are going to use lower temperature compatible with the material we have available now and define only hot channels inside the reactor where we can test the operation at the highest temperature for the next phase. So the Alfred demonstrator will be used really as a way to achieve technology maturity, in the sense that he will be able, this experimental reactor, to provide evidence that one phase is able to qualify the operation at the following phase, and so we can go step by step up in temperature, up to the temperature we want to reach. So the main idea that is that when we started the LEADER project, we had the idea to develop from a demonstrator to a prototype LFR and then to ELFR. Now, in terms of, and this is possible, however, leveraging on lead fast reactor feature, which are a very intrinsic and passive safety feature, high level of safety that we have been able to reach. We have also the exclusion of domino effect between the reactors because of the two high safety level here depicted, optimum for multi-unit site. We can foresee also a shorter deployment of Alfred with this time window target in this time frame using something that we now call a small modular fast reactor. This is the present strategy of the Falcon Consortium, and I thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Alex. It was a very informative presentation. If you have questions, I see several questions in the Q&A pod, but if you have additional questions, please go ahead and type those in now. And before we take those, we'll take a brief look at what we anticipate coming in the near future for GIF webinars. In October, a presentation on the safety of the Gen 4 reactors by Dr. Amira Able. And in November, the Allegro Experimental Gas Cooled Fast Reactor Project by Dr. Bilsofsky. And in December, a presentation on the Russia BN-600 and BN-800 by Dr. Urshurko.
And I would just like to tell Alessandro that I very much enjoyed his talk. It was very very informative, so thank you.
Thank you.
Before we start running through these questions, I do want to point out the PowerPoint, the PDF of today's presentation slides are available for download in the download PowerPoint pod on your computer screen. If you click that file name, it will download directly to your laptop or PC. And there is also a link to a survey. We always appreciate your feedback, and we take your comments seriously for opportunities for continuing improvement. And that is in that very bottom link. And I didn't address those. I apologize prior to the start of our webinar today. So without any further ado, let's start addressing some questions. How about that?
Okay, we start with the first one. Do you have some layout for DHR safety system proposed for Alfred? For sure, yes. I did not present it here. The detailed layout. Also, this layout depends strongly from the, let's say, number of steam generators that we are going to revise inside the inside the design. However, this let's say layout has been also implemented in some experimental facilities that has been built here in Italy to test the system, this system, and is going to be built, we are building now a facility in Piacenza, and the main dimension of the height, relative height of the system and so on are available in these facilities.
Then do you see the one right below it?
Yeah, what are the heat load of feed water comparing with another? With a normal preheating heat load. Let's say that maybe we can answer this question by the evaluation that we made. We made for the heat losses of Alfred. Heat losses of Alfred, if I understood well the question, are around some 100 kilowatts. So this is the order of magnitudes that we need to provide to the reactor to heat, to keep heat in temperature when the decay heat is going down to very low values.
And then
many questions. What is the height of IC comparing with SG height? The steam generator height of the tube bundle, heat exchange height is around is 6 meter. Then you have 1 meter which cross the cover gas region around. Then you have to cross the roof of the reactor, so it would be around 8 meter, the height of the steam generator. And you have at least 10 meters from the roof of the reactor to the center of the IC, isolation condenser tube bundle, just to provide the necessary height for gravity injection into the steam generator. How you remove non-condensable gas after one operation of IC? Oh, you have to isolate the system, the tube bundle and the non-condensable, and you have to remove the non-condensable from this by extracting them by a pump. Simply. Then you fill steam and extract everything from the system. This is a matter of operation after an accident and needs to be done carefully to bring again in the initial conditions the passive system. So has to be tested very, very carefully, this operation. In the event of a fuel defect, how is the lead coolant purified? We made one thing, but thank you for this question because give me the opportunity to give some more information about lead properties. Lead has a very, very good performance in terms of retention of fission products inside the lead coolant itself. So what we do in if we have a fuel defect, we will detect it from careful cover gas analysis inside the reactor, and then a purification system for the lead coolant is provided continuously into the reactor itself. In the diagram, there was a reference to 90 atom. Percent B10, which seems a bit extreme. Please discuss this and why natural boron is not used. I'm not an expert of this field. I can ask to the person that designed the core and provide you an answer by email, I think. So and we skip this this question. In the event of a primary to secondary leak, you have to remember that secondary would be at a very high pressure. In the case of leader, we have a double tube steam generator which prevents any contact between the water and lead. We suppose that we will break one tube because both tubes are able to sustain the total pressure of the water inside the tube. In any case, we will probably never have a leakage from primary to secondary, but instead we will have a secondary to primary leakage, and to prevent the pressurization of primary side, we also added some rupture disc in the rooftop with appropriate piping which provide steam dumping to pumps through spargers. How is the generation of gases like xenon, krypton, and in the reactor coolant remover? That is, does the coolant system have degasification capabilities? No. Those noble gases goes directly to the cover gas are not let's say retained by lead, obviously. So it's the cover gas purification system which takes care of this, In case of helium and tritium, also in this case, the double wall steam generator helps a lot in having some possibility to trap such gases in the gap between the two tubes. When compared MOX fuel with nitride fuel, which is better? Depends strongly from the technology development needed. I can say that in Europe, for all fast reactor designed in Europe and all demonstrator like Astrid, Allegro, Mira and Alfred, we choose MOX fuel as a reference, mainly because this fuel was already developed and the technological problem already solved for this fuel. In the past, with the development of fuel for Phoenix and Super Phoenix in France. However, for example, a completely different solution, the nitride fuel, is developed in Russia for the breast reactor, and it is the reference solution for the lead fast reactor in Russia. There are some advantages for nitrides. For example, one is the very high conductivity of the fuel, which decreases a lot the temperature and the heat stored into the pellets. But this implies a very strong technological development, which is carrying down now in Russia. We were not in Europe able to afford such a strong technology development. For control rod, is the control rod in insert state during refueling? Intuitively, the control rod should be taken out before refueling. No, they are the two systems, as I said in my slide, you can refer to it, are both inserted during refueling, just because you want to be sure nothing happened to the core during such condition. Could you please comment on any research done on SUS term during an accident involving fuel failure? Yes, we did some calculations in the LIDER project, and we supposed that the whole cladding of the core was broken, so all fission products were released to the coolant, and we had very good results because the coefficient of retention of the fission product inside lead are very high. So in terms of release to the environment, this type of accident does not constitute for this type of reactor a problem. Hello, I have a question about heat exchanger temperature profile in slide 18. I should know the question, however. But okay, you can write me the question afterward.
I think it might be the one down below. I'll post it and see if that, since it's from the same person, I'm wondering if the question has to do with the profile. He says he's never seen.
Okay. Cross each other. No, it's not possible. Maybe because the temperature scale for the lead is different from the scale for the secondary side for the water. Uh, measure feed water temperature control preheater. Okay, yes, we need to put a particular particular attention to the feed water temperature control because we do not want the feed water to reach the steam generator in conditions such that may cause allied freezing inside the steam generator. So we can use some device. One idea at the beginning of a project I tried to introduce was the presence of a big tank before entering the steam generator, in a way that if you lose a feed water heater of the last chain, which provide the increase of feed water temperature up to 335 degrees C, you have some damping through the capacity of the of this tank. There are different way of protecting heater with using available technology now, digital technologies, measuring temperature measurements or device like tanks, which passively in some way prevent any sudden change of temperature in inlet of a steam generator. You mentioned that the lead reactor is advantageous for multi-unit sites, yes. What the thermal output would test be designed at and at what efficiency? Okay. In terms of efficiency, at the beginning of ELSI and LEADER project, we tried to introduce also the possibility to have a supercritical secondary side. However, when we made calculations about the net cycle efficiency of such cycles, we discovered that the change in terms of cycle efficiency from supercritical to superheated steam cycle is only 1%, so the gain is only 43 against a 42.5%. So, however, the introduction of a supercritical cycle, steam cycle, was introducing an undue increase in the heat exchanger in the primary side, increasing the main dimension of the nacelle and so on. So we decided to go superheated in terms of secondary cycle. There are some design now that propose also at the level of generation 4 for LFR the use of supercritical CO2 cycle. This has yet to be technology developed at the size needed to feed this lead fast reactor. And the advantage would be only when you go really higher in temperature, which is not our case. So we will stay on superheated now. And the reactor is advantageous for multi-unit sites because of the intrinsic characteristic of the reactor in response to any accident. So we have an extremely low probability that an accident on one reactor is going to develop a problem on a side reactor itself. Okay, I just answered already this one. Thanks for your answer. Thank you to all the audience for attending this seminar. And if you have more questions to ask, please send me a question by email. and we'll try to give you an answer. Thank you so much.
Alex, do you see the additional, if your scroll bar, do you have time to take these last few questions that are here?
There are two more questions. I see the last one from Julian Anita, which is thanks for your answer.
And then if there's a scroll bar to your right, the next question is regarding the temperature result of decay heat removal system on page 22 from the simulation or testing, how to control the desired temperature, adjust NC gas tank pressure.
Sorry, can you repeat it?
On page 22, is the temperature result of the decay heat?
Let me go to page 22. Yeah, okay.
Is the temperature result of decay heat removal system from simulation or testing? How to control the desired temperature, adjust NC gas tank pressure?
No, there is no control at all of the temperature. We designed the system of a non-condensable gas tank and added this tank just to prevent lead freezing. But once you opened the valves of this system, both valves, which are located in, I don't know if people are saying, showing, okay. But once you open, put the system in operation, the system is completely passive. So we do not have any control on the pressure of the system, and the system is responding passively to all the thermal hydraulic condition that takes place inside the reactor.
And can you please comment on research done on source term? I apologize. Can you please comment on research done on source term during an accident involving fuel failure?
On source term after on source term when you have a cladding failure.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, thank you. I just, during my speech answering to those questions, I just said that we made simulations, and supposing the full cladding of the Alfred reactor will break and release the whole content of fission gases into the lead coolant. And we had no major consequences in terms of cover gas changes, in terms of impact, of radioactive impact, because the lead has a very, very high retention of all fission gases and prevent those gases to leave the lead bulk. So those gases are remain inside the lead coolant without going outside the liquid lead level. And this is one of very interesting properties of the lead fast reactor.
And it looks like there are just two more. Do you have a plan of irradiation experiments of fuel pins with alumina coating cladding?
We had some irradiation already of some specimen for material inside the Russian facilities for 60 namely. We are planning to have something also on in the pattern reactor inside the some let's say experimental program related to projects funded by the European Community. And of course we will need to perform some irradiation for some pins and for some fuel assemblies in prototypical conditions, because before being able to start up after the construction licensing and so on.
And then the last question is, can you say something about fuel route, storage, and reprocessing time?
This is a very interesting question. And it is one of the main problems that we are going to face inside the European Community. Development of and for refactoring, let's say, of MOX fuel and reprocessing is presently not available in Europe. So we had a strategy in terms of LFA development of a strong collaboration for fuel, let's say, manufacturing and reprocessing together with the sodium fast reactor project. So this was the main option. Those two technologies in some way different, but both using liquid metals, both needs development of MOX. There are presently some European projects working on MOX fuel, but strong development are needed before we will be able to implement reprocessing for this MOX fuel in Europe. And this is one of the main problems we have to face for the development of Alfred and most fast reactor, I would say, in Europe, not only for Alfred. I would be really happy to, if you have any more question, to answer to you by email.
Thank you. Thank you very much. What a great round of questions and presentation today. Have a great day.
Thank you to all for attending this webinar. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Ciao.